Good evening, thank you for coming to Joe's Pub. Now please welcome Lauren Weedman.
I wanna live, I wanna right ahead of time so that the universe will manifest them for me, that I am not going to do a show that is all about how bitter and fucked up I am. It's not going to be focused on how, because I have a couple divorce situations that happened in my lifetime. Not at the same time, but different times. And the second divorce, if you're going to turn on my iPad, that stumbling block is true. The second divorce, which I'm not, again, I wanted to do like a whole show about it, but I realized it bummed people out, and I had a lot of people coming up to me afterwards going like, is that true? Is that really always the Trump side that happened to you? And I don't need people all giving me that kind of, well, actually, I do need it, so anyway. So one of the goals is not to make it all bitter and talk about it. The second divorce, I think the reason I was wanting to talk about it so much is because it was my husband had an affair with our babysitter, and that's such a like, wow, oh my God. I'll tell you more about it at a different time, but it's not the focus of the show. That's what I'm trying to get away from, because it's such a bombshell. When you throw it out, people are like, what are you saying? Is that true? Did it happen? And I'm like, yeah, it did, whatever, okay. And so, and it's been a couple of years, so I'm sort of over it. They're still together, the couple. My ex-husband, Jeff, and his girlfriend. He's not my husband anymore, it's my ex. I don't know why I even said that. That's not like I'd be like, my husband, oh God, it hurt to say it, have to correct myself. Oh, I mean that, oh. I don't feel like that. And I did a whole thing in that. I was like, originally I was gonna change people's names if I did talk about it, and not call them Jeff, but because everybody was like, fuck it, Jeff, everyone's named Jeff. Every asshole I know is named Jeff. G-E-O-F-F or J-E-F-F. And so I didn't want, and then her name is Chanel, and I thought, oh, I should change that because she's just a child. I don't want to, she was 18 when it started. So maybe she's not like a baby. Her name is Chanel, and I'm like, oh, I'll change it. I'll call her Lancome or something. I don't know either, because who cares? So anyway, so it's like the show, it's not going to be all about that. But I also want to have more clarity, because a lot of times people come to me afterwards, and they're like, oh my God, I'm insane like you. I'm a squirrel like you. I'm crazy. I have to shit my hand one time too. I'm like you. And I don't want the crazy people to come to me and go like, I followed your show. My friend didn't know what was going on, but I could follow it. I'm crazy too. Call me. You guys relate to me, the most unstable in the group, whose minds don't focus, and like me, like I don't need to be the patron saint of all that shit. I don't have my meds, so I'm not going to do any more. No more revenge songs. Gunshots in it, and I had shooting the girl and everything. I'm like, and just gunshots aren't quite the holiday cheer that they used to be. And so I took it out of the show because everybody, I didn't want to deal with everybody, you know. Anyway, so none of that. I smoke a doggone thing, you cut it with a knife. Half the music's so loud, you can hear the same line twice. Hey, Leroy Brown, how do you like my big old pig? I just brought out your money out the bank today, honey. You ain't got no money. She's a movie star. I'm gonna grab her by her party go up brown. Well, don't hurt her. Just mess her hair up a little bit. That's awful. Now start crying. Act like you're the victim. Okay, now just leave her. Get on that. How you sitting? Okay, I'm just kidding. This is probably the gunshots. I'm going to be like, I'll just show you what one was really quick. I won't use it the whole time. Like, okay, let's get out of here. I'm like, oh, like that. Sure. Oh! But I would never say I got her. I'd be like, oh, I erased her. Like, oh, now she's left-handed. Oh, now she's got to play piano with her feet. Oh, now she's going to have to learn how to be a better person from the inside. With a smile, no, it's never. Maybe that explains the last few weeks you pulled me up, dead on your feet, working late again. I asked you if you said, oh my God, never. You're nobody called today. He hung up when I asked his name. Well, I wonder, does he think he's being dance party I went to, you may be thinking, he came up to me and he was like, oh my God, did you know it was a gay cruise? And as people are basically having sex, the butts everywhere. A gay cruise you could not mistake for anything else. I was performing on it, and it was great. I made a ton of money. Things are going so well for me. I just want to throw that right out. That things are going great. If anybody needs anything, like money or a place to stay, but just always come to me because I've got all sorts of things to offer because the bounty is in for me. That's all. Just leave it there. Okay, so this cruise, which she was like, you don't get paid a lot, but it doesn't matter about the money. I shouldn't make it about that. I want to unburden myself on you. Actually, I do now understand so deeply this term dumping on people, because not because of the gay cruise, but because, but after the, when I, actually, because my divorce, and I won't, again, not going to go to it a ton, but I remember when I was first telling the moms on the playground at my kids' preschool, when I would tell them what happened, because everybody thought it was, they were sure that that I had broken up with Jeff because I just got, things were going so well for me, that I was like, I need a better husband, one with softer skin, I'm sorry, and you're not, it's on my list, I made a list of everything I deserve this year, soft skin's my thing. I mean, I didn't come up with, anyway, I didn't break, okay, so everybody felt sorry for Jeff because he was always crying, and I was always like, deep voice and capable. I was always like, excuse me, I'm studying my child for preschool. And they were like, that dyke is fine. Oh, that poor man is horrible. She broke him. So anyway, I would tell, anyway, I really did not want to talk about this, that when I would tell the moms on the playground about it, I was like, well, actually what happened is, like, do you guys remember Chanel, the babysitter, Chanel? And they're like, Chanel? And I would tell them the story, and watching the horror on their faces, as I was going, I was like, yes, it happens. Sometimes the babysitter will fuck your husband. And they were just like, oh my God. And the more horrified they looked, the more I was like, oh, I'm amazing. I was like, I'm so glad I get it. On you, and I'm free. As they were just like, oh my God. Except the Persian moms, who are all just like, I like to put everybody in a category, it's so fair and advanced as me. But like, all this one, my favorite Persian mom, I told her, you're my favorite Persian mom, not just because you're a dentist, but she was the one who was like, why you let the hooker in your house? Why you let the hooker in? Don't bring coffee around the baby, don't bring chocolate in the house if you're on a diet. She had many examples of what I should have done. She's awesome. But I was on the, I was thinking of doing like Spirit in the Sky. Let's do a little, no, I'll just tell it. No, fuck it. No, you know what I'm gonna do, Brady, is I'm gonna have you not be in the show. I want you to go sit down. Don't feel bad, bro. Okay, so on the cruise, no, let's do Spirit in the Sky. It was also like coincided with me turning 47, which is gross. I'm gonna stop sin. I got a friend in Jesus, so you know that when you die. So I got asked to work on this gay cruise, and when I first heard about it, I wanted to do it because I can't, I mean, being around as many gay people as possible is always my goal. It's just like a big warm hot bath for me, just so relaxing. And so I said, yeah, the guy who hired me, his name was, let's just call him Remy Jimmy, just keep it simple and quick. Remy Jimmy told me on the phone, he's like, listen, it's really, you gotta keep your show short, because these bitches don't even wanna be there, okay? I mean, you're gonna sit down for 20 minutes, I mean, 10 minutes max, the show should be 10 minutes max. If you make it even longer than 10 minutes, you're gonna get off this fucking stage right in front of me. You gotta keep it going. And these guys got crystal meth to do and stuff to do, and they're out here for a lot of fun. And nothing against you, when they all get up and scream, shut up, and they leave, it's not against you. They're just having some kind of trouble right there, and they're gonna get on the fucking stage, over here. So I was like, it still sounds fun. And another friend of mine said, oh, don't go, don't do it. Or if you do go, don't go in the hot tub, because it's like 8-drop soup. And the first show, it's exciting, because it's a cruise, so it seems fun. And our first stop was Cape Canaveral, Florida. Everybody else, we're in Florida. Don't forget your cameras. It's the distance of the most exotic of locales, but whatever, fuck it. I like performing, and I love the hormones, so I'm, you know, wonderful. So, and the first show, I'm about to go on, and the guy who's the big mama on the boat, Malcolm, who sort of hosts everything, he's like the Julie McCoy, and he comes up to me, and he was like, just so you know, when Vanessa Williams was doing her show, and I was like, oh, is he thinking of, I was beside her, and one said he was going to compare me to, he was, when Vanessa Williams did her show, you know, some of the guys didn't like it, because she just did her show, and didn't make it about them. The key is to make it about them as much as possible, otherwise they're going to get up, you crystal meth, and fuck the stage. So hurry. And so and he said, and you know what? The show when they started falling in love with Vanessa Williams, she came out on stage and she said, hello, bitches. That was it? And I'm like, wow, she's a Vanessa Williams. We tried it out. And I was like, hello, bitches. And they were like, ah. And so then I did the show, and it didn't go very, it was okay, right? It was okay. Brady was there, sorry. But it felt, people didn't get up and leave. It was hot. Oh, I got a friend in Jesus. So you know that when you die, he's gonna recommend you. And by like the second or third day, first of all, you walk down the hallways, and I kept having conversations with people, thinking, people are so rude, and nobody really connected. And I realized everybody's fucked up. Everybody on the boat is just like, hi, I saw your show. That's my hand. And they're walking away. And I was like, what's wrong with everybody? And finally, people are like, everybody's on G. You know what G is? And I was like, E, F, G, 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 G. a little bit. There's like drugs everywhere, and I saw so many naked butts, and I'm pro butts, I'm not against it. But after a while, constantly seeing like guys in line with their like with their naked butts and their free muffins, and I was like, ah, I smell poop. I started to get sort of crabby towards the end. And at first I would be the dance club all the time, because I loved it. I loved dancing, I loved being on the cruise, everything like that. And then we had to pay for our own drinks. And it was cheaper probably if I would have done Jeeves. You can't drink if you name Jeeves, you'll die. I didn't know what the drug is. I was just so like, it was weird to be in an environment where it's just so young. People are like, hey, how you doing? Do you want some cocaine? I'm like, not right now. Can you buy me a Diet Coke? It's $17. When I get back, they're like, no, just take the cocaine. I'm like, oh, okay, I'll have Diet Coke. I can't, so it was way cheaper to do that, right? What was the sort of turning point of the, I remember at one point, I was at the, when I realized that this is turning corner, I need to stop going out. I used to be in my state room, like, you know, go out for the shows, have nobody show up, and then just wait till I'm home. Where it was when I was waiting on the dance floor at one point, some kid came up to me, and he was just like, hey, do you want a half an Adderall? I'll go get your half an Adderall. And I was like, okay, I'll wait here. And I'm sitting there waiting for 20 minutes for a half an Adderall, just because I want to be part of the party somehow. I couldn't get my Diet Coke. I went home. And stay for that. Oh, bitches! I never stand. I got a friend, and it's so really sweet. But people who like the show looking were coming up to me. Super sweet, really nice, amazing fans. And then there was a deaf guy that I saw that came up to me. Yeah, I saw him. That's the end of my story. I saw a deaf guy. And here's the picture. No, he came up to me and he was like, telling me how much he loved the show and I loved hearing about that. And then he goes, Dan Johnson, Grant, I want to fuck it, pop, and I'll go like this. And he's telling me, and his interpreter is there as he was talking, interpreting it as if he had to. This guy was like, I can get the deaf guy. So I was like, I don't know what to fuck it, and this interpreter go, he wants to suck his cock and he wants him to fuck him really hard in his ass. I was like, I think I got it. That's good. You know, I also thought it'd be much better to be on a gay cruise than a lesbian cruise, though. So I've heard the lesbian cruises, they're like, you have to clean up the beaches when you get there. That was one of the parties were like pajama parties. You know, and conversations aren't about drugs, they're about like, you know, well, I was in a Nigerian prison, I'll tell you what, don't have good coffee there. Thanks for playing along there, Brady, making it just seem like even more. So, guess what happened, bitches? No, it's more like this. I'm gonna take a workshop super soon on how to play the ukulele. It's gonna be amazing. Let me tell you all a story about a Harper Valley widow wife who had a teenage daughter who attended Harper Valley Junior High. Came home one afternoon and didn't even stop to play. And she said, Ma, I got no hit from the Harper Valley PTA. Well, the next of Miss Johnson, even worry dress is way too high. It's been reported you've been drinking and having a run around with men and acting wild. And we don't believe you ought to be to bring it up your little girl this way. I'm of the Secretary Harper Valley PTA. Well, it happened that the PTA was coming up this very afternoon. The chances were sure surprised when Miss Johnson wore a miniskirt into the room. And as she walked up to the blackboard, I could still recall the words she had to say. She said, I'd like to address this meeting of the Harper Valley PTA. Well, there's Bobby Taylor sitting there, and seven times he's asked me for a name. Hey, babe. And Mrs. Taylor, she seems to use my eyes whenever he's away. And Mr. Baker came to tell us why your secretary had to leave this town. Children will just be told the keeper when no shakes up all the way to town. bet you'll find that she's had a little nip of gin. And then you have the nerve to sit there and tell me as a mother I'm not fit. Fuck you. Yo, you're so big, why don't you come up here and say to my face, you fucking cow. You got a cow titty, you got one big ass cow titty, one little ass cow titty. Fuck you. Well, go have your kids go sled on dirt some more. Go ahead. Fuck you, skanky ass motherfucker. Fuck you, man. I don't need you in my face like this right now. Yes, you do. Your kids are selling their own snot at school, okay? Yes, they are. Fuck you, you piece of shit. Absolutely they are. Yeah. Explain, okay. Yeah, well, why'd you put those stickers on your baby's nipples? I knew. Who put stickers on a newborn's nipples? That's true. Why don't you ask her? Yeah, she getting up, pulling up her skirt, acting like she crazy fucking hoe. Come on up here. This is just a little pink place, and you're all valley hypocrites. Well, I would put you on because it really didn't happen just this way. The day my mama socked it to the Hopper Valley PTA. Brady, you encouraged me too much. You're always like, Lauren, that sounds great. You have to do it. I'm like, I don't think it's that good. You're like, you got it, babe. You got it. You see what happens? This is what happens. I mean, this is what happened to Eddie Murphy. Everyone's like, no, man, you're doing great. You can't be happy. You can't have yes people around you. Next thing I'm like, he don't have that pretty in my wedding gown. He said never take it off. He said I can play ukulele and I can sing like a bird. Shh, baby. My very dear friend, Jonathan Groff, is not here. Not yet. Oh, Brady can't stand to see an instrument on the floor because he respects my music. And he's a real musician. That's so my beer. That's all you did. That's all the whole cruise. It's me, like, I'll be talking to somebody, and then I'd hear Brady's voice in my ear, ask him to buy me a beer. By the way, can you buy Brady a beer? I'm gonna fuck you later. Brady is someone I've been playing music with after my divorce. We dated briefly, and nothing is more healing than the power of music. You're like, sis, we're golden hair. I saw a little video the other day, viral video, about how this guy was playing the ukulele for somebody who's trapped in an escalator. Did you see that? Or an escalator. Trapped in an escalator. Help me! We can't help you! I can't get the rhythm, sorry. I'll find somebody who can play ukulele to call my parents while you're stuck on the escalator. Jesus Lord. Not the brightest. I always have my ukulele down. Ukulele for somebody who's stuck in the elevator. It's really sweet, and it just you see him playing. I'm like, oh, it's like Brady. He's like, I was like stuck in the elevator or of my life, and then you play music. It's really sweet. So that's Brady Harris on guitar.
right, but it's
over. I know, but I can't let go. You don't like to see me standing around. Feel like I've been shot before that was over. I know, but I can't let go. Bouncer put her on the ground and was stepping on her on the throat, and people were walking by screaming at her. New York City! Oh, and then I said, and then I was on Murray Hill, and I saw a guy, and I was like, God, I love curry. I need to get a curry while I'm here. And then a guy came running out of an Indian restaurant, and he threw up on the ground. New York City! Just like I pictured it. I'm so glad you guys actually came, because I know I felt bad for the waitstaff coming in, and it was just like, great, I'm glad I passed every barbecue in the world, and people all like, oh, time for my picnic, do I have enough sunscreen on? It's like, I'm going to work, you fucker. Like, I felt bad for people having to work, and of course, all the people that texted me throughout the day, sorry, Lord, my car exploded. I can't come to the show. Sorry, Lord, my eyeballs fell out overnight. Sorry, Lord. I'm a fan of Lucinda Williams, and so I was going to do a part of the show where I had her as a puppet, and it kind of looks like this, because I felt like she's kind of my spirit animal, and I can't get her to be a guest, but though she lives in L.A. somewhere, she lives in Studio City.
Studios.
Yeah, man, I'm in the Trader Joe's. So I'm going to have her sing a song. Okay. Yeah. Oh, okay, you're in your 60s, right? 63, man. So, do you finally feel comfortable in your own skin? Does it get better? You know what I mean? Do you ever stop? Can I get that for you? And everybody understands that feeling, so don't feel weird right now? Alright, man. I just woke up. You're on yourself bragging, trying to be strong. You feel bad when you've done nothing wrong. Love got confused with anger and pride. So much abusing such a little child. Someone who loved you told you to shut up. Now there's a pain in your gut you can't get rid of. No one heard your screams when you were nine. Your bad dreams for your summertime. So you don't always show your sweet side. You don't always show your sweet side. You don't always show your sweet side. You got a sweet side, baby. You got a sweet side. Can't tell if I should say that. You're tough for steel and you keep your chin up. You never feel like you're good enough. You've had the blues ever since you were six, in your little tennis shoes and your pickup sticks. You've been screamed at and kicked over and over when you always feel sick and you can't keep a lover. Every Christmas there were presents to unwrap, but the thing that you wear is your 5 1/2. So you don't always show your sweet side. You don't always show your sweet side. You don't know we show your sweet side. Oh my God, are you okay? Get your side, baby. I've seen you in the kitchen cooking me supper. I've listened to your bitching and I've watched you suffer. I still love you, baby, because I know you don't mean to do the cruel things you do. I see you sew buttons on your shirt. I've seen you throwing up when your stomach hurt. I see by you, baby, thick and thin, no matter what kind of state you're in. Because I see your sweet side. I see your sweet side. I see your sweet side. You got a sweet side, baby. You got a sweet side. You're just tired. You get super tired. Did you have weed today? That's what I thought. I was gonna sleep. My Al-Anon sponsor told me to sing that song. I also wanted to thank my ex-husband Jeff. Because he taught me that anything is possible. Anything that you think could happen could actually happen. You know what I mean? Like, you're like, that would never happen! And even the fact that the worst thing ever happened made me believe that anything's possible. And I thought, well, that gets really jokes. I'm like, no, that would, he would never like actually be with her. Like that would never be. When I found the video, I was like, that's not her. That's not our babysitter. You know, I'm like, no. And I'm like, my God, it is. I'm like, what's next? Maybe I'll win the Pulitzer. You know what I mean? Because who knows? Maybe the moon will explode. You don't know. There's no rhyme or reason in any of it. You know, which is kind of cool. It kind of made my head kind of just, you know, open up to everything. So I really should say, oh yes, I think so. Don't shame, darling, don't shame. Thank you for all the joy and pain. Picture show, second balcony, was the place we'd meet, second see, go Dutch treat. You were sweet, don't shame, darling, don't shame. Say those lies, be little, I should be sneaking out of you.
The mogul that he was, and part of the interview, he was in prison. They were all like, so we get to meet him soon. So honest. And they also did this thing where during our, you'd walk in for the job fair, and it was like they're looking for actors, models, jugglers, outgoing people. And you walk in, and they wouldn't even like, I was like, well, I've worked in restaurants, I've been waiting tables, and they were like, you go sit over there with the 90-year-old men and the 17-year-old boys, okay? I sat at a table, like, I was like, this doesn't look like where I should be sitting, and then basically they were dividing you up into different groups based on your looks. And it wasn't anything to do with your skill set. It was all like, if you were really tall and super good looking, they were like, clearly you've had a lot of bartending experience. I was just like, no, because my hands can't grip anything except, you know, and they're like, looks like you've got the will to learn over there. And I come in and they're like, looks like you can maybe carry a really heavy tray. Go over there and room service. And so I quit, because I went up and I realized I was in room service and all the fun people were working in the restaurant, like Simone and Francis, I think is here too, and then they were all there. And so I was like, well, I'm quitting, because I'm fun. And I, to show my fun spirit, I was like, I don't think I should be with the room service people. I would like to be, over there in the cafeteria with the people in the cafeteria of the restaurant. And he was like, ooh, you're kind of saucy. Okay, we'll give you a shot. And I was like, thank you, I'll prove myself. I worked there. Okay, so, help me, Woody and Kenobi, you're my only hope. At first I was afraid, I was petrified. Kept thinking I could never live without you by my side. And then I spent so many nights just thinking how you've not made wrong, I am strong. Long distance relationship alive.
by making sure you're having a lot of sex and any intrigue that come up and that's really close to you, yeah. All right, and you don't even notice it, right? And when you see them, you're like, oh, I forgot I was even in something. It's exciting. You know, it's always a big thing. It's like seeing somebody new every time. So I think that's that hot tip. Dear Lauren, how do you make an open relationship work? Oh, fucker. Okay, so you make an open relationship work. First of all, it's really important if you're into open relationships to always have like a really bushy tongue and wear cardigans all the time. And always be telling people about how you're in an open relationship. Oh, it's so cool. It's really the only way to be. Would you rather know somebody? Or would you rather live in truth? I'd rather be lied to and actually have some good sex with somebody who's got a tongue that doesn't have like a muscle in it. That's right, I think an open relationship work. I don't know, just be mentally ill at the rest of the okay. That's the only way to be. Are you scared, Lauren? And make sure when someone tells you they're not in an open relationship, oh, shame those dum-dums. I don't really get it, do you? No, I'm gonna wait for all the evolved people my evolved open relationship plan to join me. So go ahead, like, okay. What's the weirdest thing you've ever thought about during sex? Probably sex. Dear Lord, when is it time to move in together? I say right away. I say on the first date, you're like, this is so weird, but I want to move in with you. And then when they say no, I say, where do you live? Where do you work? And then they go, I won't talk about that. Find out where they work. And then show up at work. Don't go inside the building. Find out like a little vantage spot where they can be spotted. And just let them know that thinking about you. And just keep at it. Because you have to let people know that you are committed. Because nobody believes that anyone's going to really stay there for them. So they'll get to the point where you're at their wedding. Just don't give up, because people always think give up too easy. So now go! Turn on in bed. I like it when people cry, and I like it when I hear people go ow ow, and I really like it when I hear someone go oh stop alter it. Dear Lord, what happened between you and Brady earlier this year? The fuck was this, Brady? I told you what happened. Backstage, you have to like write it on a card. What happened? You know exactly what happened. My God. Don't talk during the show, Brady. Don't talk during the show. Do you have a parting of the ways? What happened is that I've been doing some hospice volunteering, and the volunteering became so intensive, the hours, that I have to make a choice. I'm also a mother, and so I thought, I've got to be there for my child. So I thanked Brady so deeply for the journey that we've been on. And I said, good luck to you, Brady. And I said, oh, well, don't leave too soon. I said, Brady, left some beer behind. You wouldn't want to do that, would you, Brady? That was all. So that's fine. That's about it. Thank you for asking, though. Yeah. Oh, Brady, they almost heard you. Almost on my back. Okay. Running other ways. Okay. Why do men want to fix everything?
I know.
Why do men want to scratch their balls? Oh, man. They just got away everywhere. Why can't men ask for directions? You should write for Sprint or something like that. Sprint commercials. Sorry. Thank you for asking. Walk out the door. Just turn around. You're the one who tried to break me with his eyes. I think I've, oh my God, did I think I've made out of that? Oh no, not I, Jesus Christ. My partner and I seem to be coming from different worlds sometimes. Oh, Venus and Mars. It's so true, sometimes we're so different. Sometimes I'll be tired and I'll be in front of somebody who's not. It's weird, isn't it? And I'll be hungry and they won't be. I'm always like, wait a second, but I'm hungry. It makes no sense, and I'll punch myself, and they don't feel it. Isn't that weird how humanity can be? My partner and I, since I'm homo, and I seem to be coming from different worlds sometimes. It can be frustrating. What can I do? Well, I think one thing to do is to, when you're fighting, do something like cut yourself. Just maybe like, oh, because then he has to be in your world, because he has to take you to the emergency room. He'll be in the same world. Pegging, sure, yes, maybe. I am 190 years old. I don't know what pegging is. And somebody on the boat said that. I go, can you find Brandon for me? I mean, Jimmy Remy. And they're like, I'll peg him. I was like, I know you will. Can you go find him? All right. Dear Lauren, is it ever okay to look at someone's phone without permission? Did you?
I
feel kind of squeal all of a sudden. Sometimes you look at it because you're just trying to see if they've been talking to someone that should be. I don't know. It's not what you're forced to. I'm forced to snoop sometimes because you have to find out stuff like tax information. Or if a child is in danger. Like by one time when I was on your phone, I was worried there was a child in danger. And I can't let a kid be hurt. We will survive. Yeah, as long as I'm a little hot, no, I'll be a lot. Thank you so much, let me change your lives in this very heartbreaking way. Thank you. So I was at after my first divorce, my second divorce, I was at my first one, doesn't matter. I was at a audition because you got to keep going, you got to move on, and I got a feature. And I was at an audition, and I had these fake diamond earrings on, cubic zirconias, as they're called. And the casting woman said, "Wow, look at those earrings! Wow, somebody really loves you, huh?" And I said, "No." Turned out that he didn't love me. Comma, comma, down, dibby, do, down, down. Comma, comma, down, dibby, do, down, down. Comma, comma, down, dibby, do, down, down. Breaking up is hard to do. Don't take your love away from me. Don't you leave my heart in misery. If you go, then I'll be blue. Breaking up is hard to do. Right when I decided that my depression had lifted and I'd like to start dating again, little white spots appeared all over my body. I thought, oh good, I've got ringworm now. So I went to the dermatologist and she said, oh no, that's not ringworm, that's just a fungus. I said, oh my god, that sounds awful. She said, oh no, it's just from not showering, that's all. I said, that sounds worse. She goes, oh stop it, Lauren, it's just like athlete's foot, but all over your body. Remember when you held me tight and you kissed me all through the night. Come on baby, let's start anew. There's a pill, she suggested. I can give you a pill. It's going to clear that fungus right up. You take it for 4 days, and the only thing that's very important during those 4 days, don't drink any alcohol. And I asked if maybe there was another option. I did too. And she said, Lauren, if you can't go 4 days without drinking alcohol, we need to have a different conversation. They say that breaking up is hard to do.
Say that this is the end. Instead of breaking up, I wish that we will make it up again.
There's an ointment she suggested that I could use. She said, now just take the ointment, put it on in the evening, and you may want to ask your husband or your partner to help you put it on because you've got a lot of that fungus down the middle of your back. She said, make sure he puts it on before you go to bed at night. And I said, well, I don't have a husband or a partner to put on my ointment. To some of my senior citizen patients, I have them take the ointment and put it on like a door jamb, and they just go up to it. I beg of you, don't say goodbye. Won't you give my love another try? Come on, baby, let's start anew. Gonna break it all that's hard to do. Comma, comma, down, dooby, do, down, down. Comma, comma, down, dooby, do, down, down. Comma, comma, down, dooby, do, down, down. Breaking up is hard to do. Right.
City, born and raised, but now and
I'm stuck between two shores. LA's fine, but it ain't home. New York's home, but it ain't mine no more. I am, I said. How many people are sick of the city right now? To no one there. And no one heard it all, not even a chair. Oh, you're sitting right, usually, like. That cherry one. I am, said I, and I am lost, and I can't even say why. Leaving me lonely still. I hate living in LA so much. It's a sight. You ever hear that story about the frog who dreamed of becoming a king? And became one. Well, except for the names and a few of the changes, if you're talking about me. Oh my God, the story's the same. I got into this deep inside and I've tried, but it won't let me go. I'm not a man who likes to swear, but I never care for the sound of being alone. You think I'd be used to it then, I say. To no one there, and no one heard it all, not even a chair. You're still sitting there, I told you I was going to do that. I am, I cried, I am, said I, and I am lost and I can't even say why. So profound story of my life. I was trying to like talk over you having some kind of reaction or feeling like you had to support me. I had a moment of, I hate people get super self-deprecating on stage, like, I have no business standing up here. Please, what am I doing? I know you're all really here. I'm sorry I'm taking up stage time from Gad. I like sold out 90 show up, I'll tell you. Okay, but I did have a moment while I was singing where I was like, I'm not a singer. Well, okay, never mind. I'm like, I can't believe, oh, I'm singing it. I can't believe I'm gonna sing it. I can't believe I'm at Joe's Pub. I'm so fucking happy to be here. I'm too embarrassed to admit that I'm so excited about it. That's why John Stewart hated me. That's why he told me. I heard that about one of the first things that one of the producers said to me. They're like, John thinks you just act like, he just can't really tell if you're excited to be here. You can't tell, you know, he thinks you're treating this whole thing like it's a walk in the park. And I was like, I thought that was called being cool. And she goes, no, it's called being fired. So. Okay, so let me, okay, good, perfect. Just to sort of sum it up, actually when I was home is that when I was home in Indianapolis recently, woo! I was, yes, I know, woo, stick mouse. And so, though apparently it's better for the homosexuals, because I always was like, oh, so conservative there. I have a friend who's a DJ, and he was saying that he was living in a small town in Indiana, just moved back to Indianapolis. He's like, it's so much better here. He's like, I gotta tell you how great it is to come back to work on a Monday and not have to change all my pronouns when I'm talking about what I did over the weekend. You know, it's, now I don't have to in Indianapolis. And I'm like, that must be exhausting. You're like, oh my God, so I was sucking her cock. My mother, I was complaining to her, I go, why is that? I go, none of your, I've got two other sisters, the ones who were not adopted, the real ones, we like to call them, and the adopted one. I know because I sat at the adopted table at Thanksgiving, that was my giveaway. So, but my real sister, no, I go, none of us we're all divorced and we're all single mothers, so that's cool. And I said to my mom, adopted mama, I was like, adopted mama, do you realize the fact that none of your daughters have been able to stay in relationships or, you know, have men in their lives? Does that ever occur to you how insane that is? Or do you ever wonder why? And she's like, not really. You're not the easiest people in the world to put up with. So I was like, oh, adopted mama, thank you for that pearl. Then again, also my therapist last night, and I'll go, my therapist, Jay, who texts me all the time, which seems weird. My friend's like, your therapist should not be texting you. And I'm like, well, he cares about me. Like, ooh, what was that? He texted me and he's like, you know, you can't have it all, Lauren. I was just thinking about it. You're always frustrated about not being able to find love, but you can't have it all. And I was like, oh, fuck you, stop texting me. And I was like, don't think so. But maybe it's helpful for you guys. Once upon a time, there was a tavern where we used to raise a glass or two. Remember how we danced away the hours and dreamed of all the great things we would do. Those were the days, my friend, we thought they'd never end. We'd sing and dance forever and a day. We'd live the life we choose, we'd fight and never lose, for we were young and sure to have a way. And he was like, I saw you over there dancing with that guy. That was really inappropriate to see my wife over here, like, grinding up against him. I was like, and he's gay, it doesn't count. He was like, you know what, Lauren, like, sing along to these hip-hop songs. And, you know, I thought you were a feminist. It doesn't really look really good. No one wants to see a white lady rapping, okay? I was like, how do you want to fuck? Bitch, I'm me. I'm a goddamn reason you and me on a PC. See, no, we don't have to see at me. I'm constructing wildlife, Chiali.
Started singing in the streets. People would throw me pennies so I could hit.
friends are all.